We're talking about the Exodus today. The Exodus, I think, is the Old Testament's biggest theme, which is why I titled it the Old Testament's biggest theme. And a lot of the information for the class today can be found in a short book called Against the Gods. It's by John Currid. It's an excellent book. John Currid is a professor at Reformed Seminary in Charlotte. He really specializes in biblical texts that have reference to Egypt. And so, of course, that has heavy impact on our material, particularly the Exodus. So we'll be talking about how the Exodus is largely an account of who the real God is, and that the book of Exodus is written to demonstrate that God is our God, is a real God. And a lot of that information will come straight out of here in this Against the Gods book. So if you're interested, you can either just write it down quick, or you can ask me about it later and I'll show it to you. And you can get it on Amazon for a pretty reasonable price. But we'll get started. I'll pray for us, and then we'll dive right into what hopefully will be a full and productive time again. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your incredible mercy upon us. We thank you that you have revealed yourself to us as the one God who has made the heavens and the earth and everything in them. We pray that as we look at this really important part of your word and really foundational for many of our understandings of who you are and what you have done, we pray that you'd help us to understand it and to be able to put it together in the big picture of the scriptures as well. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, we are in the Exodus, and the book of Exodus is meant to play off the book of Genesis. There's real strong connections between the two. And of course, as we talked about last week, the very last words in the book of Genesis are in Egypt. Right, and then you begin chapter 1 of Exodus, and you find the people of God in Egypt, exactly where they had said they were going to be. It helps us to understand a little bit of the context of the book of Exodus if we understand it in relationship to the political climate of its own day. So when Joseph goes to Egypt and goes and rises into the position of power in the court of Pharaoh, when Joseph does that, it's about 1800 B.C., the C there means for circa 1800 B.C., which means around 1800 B.C. And during that time, that was the time of the 15th Egyptian dynasty. Pretty incredible that we're on, what, our 46th president or something like that, and, you know, we're in the year 2018. They were already on their 15th dynasty by the year 1800 B.C. But this dynasty was a dynasty of immigrants. Asiatic immigrants from the Middle East and other places in the Near East had migrated into Egypt en masse, much like Abraham had done, and they had become so powerful, they had become the reigning dynasty in the land of Egypt. So when Joseph comes into Pharaoh's household, he comes into people who are culturally quite similar to him. They would have, the rulers had assimilated some kind of Egyptian practices, they despised shepherds just like the ethnic Egyptians did, but it was really generally a friendly dynasty to Asian migrants. So then you jump forward 400 years to the time when you have the Exodus begins and Moses is born, and it's a time of political upheaval, because you have the 18th dynasty, which is an ethnic Egyptian dynasty. So the ethnic Egyptian pharaoh has expelled all the former dynasty, has kicked the former dynasty out of Egypt, and of course, therefore, views anybody who's of Asian descent, views them as political threats, which makes perfect sense why they would seek to enslave the Israelites who were of Asian descent and to make sure that they wouldn't rise to power again. Right? That helps us to make kind of some background sense of why this new pharaoh, who doesn't know anything about Joseph, seems to hate the Israelites and wants to enslave them. How do they go from Joseph saves Egypt to let's kill everybody who's a male descendant of Joseph? Well, this helps to explain it. It's an entirely different dynasty, entirely different government. And it's most likely that this happens during the reign of Pharaoh Akhmose. The word Moses, we'll see in just a moment, means son of, so son of Ah. He claims to be the son of a God. That gives us an understanding of kind of the politics of the time. And this map, and you can look up this later if you want, but this map shows the situation of Egypt in the world at the time of the Exodus. It's really an Egyptian world. This is the point of time when Egypt's ancient power rises to its zenith. Egypt not only controls all the land here in this dark green, but really exercises control over all of the all what we call the Levant in Palestine. It's an incredibly powerful dynasty, and so there's really no challenging the power, the political military power of Pharaoh at the time of the Exodus. And so it's during this time, at the height of their power, that the Egyptians are trying to make sure that there's no internal dissent at home as they try to expand their power abroad. Part of that attempting to quell any internal dissent is enslaving anybody who's not ethnic Egyptian. And of course, the descendants of Jacob find themselves easily within that category. So then we see that that while they were trying to enslave the Israelites were fruitful and multiplied, which is exactly as God had commanded Adam to do and had promised Abraham that his descendants would do. And so the Egyptians become concerned that their policy of enslaving the Israelites is not having its desired effect. They're getting bigger and stronger and bigger and stronger. So that's when the Pharaoh institutes a new policy that all the baby boy Israelites are going to be thrown into the Nile River to be drowned. And that, of course, would do the trick, right? If you want to make sure that there's no more Israelites to cause a problem, you get rid of all of one of the sexes, especially if it's the male who is the stronger, the warrior sex, then you throw them into the river, you have solved your problem with these foreign people who are in your land. But it's more than just a clever political ploy, right? It's a satanic attack on the promises of God. Because God had promised that through the seed of the woman, which that promise had then been made to Abraham as well and carried from Abraham on through Judah, that through the seed of the woman, he was going to crush the head of the serpent. As this promise is traced through Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and then Judah, then this is an attack not only on the people of Israel, but it's an attack on God himself. And we see this same thing plays itself out multiple times in the story of the scripture. You have Cain murdering Abel. Then you have the threat in the flood. You have this threat. And later with David and his descendants, you have Athaliah trying to kill all the royal sons. There's this perpetual attempt to try to kill off the line of the promise. And it's exactly what Herod does. Herod orders all the baby boys of Bethlehem, 2 years old and under, to be murdered. It's all a satanic attempt for the seed of the serpent to destroy the seed of the woman. And so we see that through Moses, God preserves his promise as well. So this helps us to place the story of Exodus, not just an interesting story or even just a really important story, but it places it in the trajectory of the Bible story. It's a threat to the promise, which draws the drama of the story much more to the forefront. Then we have a Savior. We have a Savior who himself gets saved. So there's a story, you're probably well familiar with it, the Hebrew woman, Jochebed, she has a child. She sees the child is beautiful. I'm not sure what exactly that means. I never met a mother who thought their child wasn't beautiful. I always said that I was going to be honest enough that if I had a kid who wasn't cute when they were a baby, I was going to admit it. And Grace was not cute as a baby, and I kept my word. But I think she's cute now. But mothers always think their children are cute. So I'm not exactly sure what it means that Moses' mother thought that her child was special, but she did. And she creates this papyrus basket. But really, the Hebrew term is she creates a papyrus ark. It's the same term that's used of Noah's ark. And it's a saving vessel. And it's more than just saving Moses, but it's saving the Savior. It's saving Moses, who's going to be the one who saves the people of God entirely. And so she coats this basket with pitch and tar, and she places it in the weeds of the Nile River, and then Providence has it. Pharaoh's daughter goes down, finds the baby, has mercy upon the baby, and Pharaoh's own daughter houses this child, raises this child in her own household. So ironically, inside the household of Pharaoh, who's trying to destroy the Israelites, is the Savior who's going to save the very people that Pharaoh is going to destroy. That's drama, right? That's irony. It's all kinds of literary genius. It's all kinds of providential genius. And we see that this pops up again, and it's mentioned in Acts 7, verses 18 to 22. Does anybody have Josh? Read it real loud for us.
Then another king who knew nothing about Joseph became ruler of Egypt. He dealt treacherously with our people and oppressed our forefathers by forcing them to throw out their newborn babies so that they would die. At that time, Moses was born, and he was no ordinary child. For 3 months, he was cared for in his father's house. When he was placed outside, Pharaoh's daughter took him and brought him up as her own son. Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in speech and action.
Yeah, so it's great irony, and it comes across again in Acts, that Moses is raised in Pharaoh's household. And as one who's raised in Pharaoh's household, though he was nursed by his own mother at the age of 4 or so, he would have just been a freak from her and been entirely under the tutelage of Pharaoh and his academics, philosophers, even his theologians. Moses very easily could have taken on a purely Egyptian identity, but as we see, he doesn't do that. And Moses has to come to grips with who he is. The term Moses means son of. So Achmos is son of Ah. Other pharaoh is Thutmos, son of Thut. Oftentimes you'd have son of a god. Moses is just Mose, son of, well, Pharaoh's daughter didn't know who he was the son of. He was an orphan, right? He was found in the middle of the Nile River, and he's just there. And so he has an Egyptian name, means son of, we don't know. His name means an orphan, but as we'll see, he really, truly is a son of God. Not the son of God, of course, but he's a son of God, and God is going to take care of him. But Moses recognizes that he has a true identity. His identity is not in Pharaoh's household, but his identity is with the people of God. And we see this a number of different places. I don't have Hebrews 11:23 on the sheet, but if someone would look that up for me real quick, and I'll come back to that in just a second. But there, when Moses comes of age, he begins to demonstrate that he is a savior. Because first he engages in a conflict. An Egyptian taskmaster is beating a Hebrew slave, and Moses intervenes, and he kills the Egyptian taskmaster. He saves the Israelites. Then the second time, there's two Israelites who are squabbling, and he intervenes on behalf of the innocent Israelite. Right? And then he demonstrates himself to be a savior of the innocent, a savior of the oppressed. That's when the other Israelite says, what are you going to do? Kill me like you killed the Egyptian? Moses realizes he's in big trouble. His secret is known. He decides he's going to run away. So Moses runs away. He ends up at this well in Midian. And we'll see a map of Midian just in the next slide. Ends up at a well of Midian. And there there's these shepherds who are harassing the daughters of Jethro. And Moses saves the daughters of Jethro from the shepherds. And he demonstrates himself 3 times in a very short span of time to be a savior. He's a saving personality. And he has to recognize this identity about himself. Talk about an identity crisis, right? You're born to slave parents. You probably recognize, even just facially, genetically, that you look more like the slaves than you look like the Egyptian household you were raised in. But all of your education, all of your background, everything that you've learned and all the culture you've engaged in says that you're an Egyptian. So this is a real choice. There's an internal conflict Moses is prone to have. So who has Hebrews 11:23 for me? Z, would you read it?
Sure. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born, because they saw he was no ordinary child, and they were not afraid of the king's edict.
Keep going. Yeah. Through 27, sorry.
Okay. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated him, along with the people of God, rather than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a short time. He regarded the disgraces for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the resources of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who was invisible. By faith he kept the path over and the sprinkling of blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn.
So we see that Moses has to receive his identity as a person of God, as an Israelite by faith. He doesn't have to, he's not forced into it. He chooses to identify himself with the people of God. So if we go back to that map, Moses has to flee Egypt. The Israelites lived up in this region of Egypt. He has to flee. He flees all the way across the wilderness to Midian, and that's where he finds refuge for 40 years. He marries a Midianite woman, Zipporah, and her father's name was Jethro, so he flees Egypt. We read that in chapter 2, verses 11 to 15. And then And then we have a very dramatic scene where God reveals who he is. Because Moses flees, and then he's at Mount Horeb, which is Mount Sinai as well. He's pasturing some flocks there. And Moses comes across this very strange sight. There's a bush burning that isn't consumed by the fire. So he draws near. We know the story, right? The Lord speaks out of the bush, "Take off your shoes. The place where you're standing is holy ground." He has this conversation with Moses. He tells Moses Moses is going to be the one that goes back and saves his people. Moses says, "How about somebody else?" And God keeps saying, "No, it's going to be you." And Moses says, "Well, who should I say sent me?" And the Lord says, "I am who I am." That is an incredibly important part of the scripture. Because God identifies himself not first and foremost with what he does, but with his being. Right, that's entirely different than all the rest of the gods. All the rest of the gods identify themselves primarily by what they do. I'm the god of the sky, I'm the god of the sea, I'm the god of the crops, right? I make the sun rise or whatever like that, right? But God just says, "I am who I am." That is, that he is an essential, necessary being. Also, of course, philosophically, this is the only kind of God that makes sense. A God who just simply is. Right? We can have a regress, an ultimate regress. You've got to go back. What came first, the chicken or the egg? Good question. Well, there has to be someone who made either a chicken or an egg first, right? Well, who made that being? Well, there eventually has to be a being, a personal being who just is. God, already back in 1400 BC or so, identifies himself to Moses as the God who simply is. He's an unchanging, infinite, eternal, pre-existent, self-existent being. So this God then is going to send Moses back to go deal with Pharaoh. And he sends him back and he says to Moses, "Behold, I have made you like God to Pharaoh." Pharaoh was believed to be a god. He was believed to be a god incarnate. We'll come to that. And here God says to Moses, "You're going to do divine battle with Pharaoh. We're going to show Pharaoh, we're going to show Egypt, we're going to show my own people who is really God." So that sets up what really happens in the account, at least the first half of the book of Exodus. The first half of the book of Exodus is portrayed to us as divine battle. And really, there's two rounds. The first round is the battle of the rods. Which God has a more powerful rod? Which God's rod is worthy of law, as I wrote? So Pharaoh was believed to be a son of the gods. He was believed to be the sun god Ra incarnate, and also the incarnation of the gods Horus, and he was believed to have the power of Osiris. He is the physical incarnation of the gods themselves. And when the Pharaoh would become king, he would receive a rod. A very kind of a sickle-shaped rod, very decorative, very ornate. And it was the Egyptians believed that the power of the gods actually resided inside the rod. Okay, so when you see a rod in the story of Exodus, it's not just a nice stick that's used for walking. The pharaohs and their magicians' rod were believed to have within themselves the power of the god that they represented. And so when Pharaoh would take his vows as king, he would receive the rod of Ra and Osiris and Horus. And even the seal of the Egyptian pharaohs was the eye of Horus. You see that sign all over the place, there's the eye. That's the eye of Horus. It comes from a myth where Horus lost his eye to Seth, the god of disorder and chaos. Then in battle, he receives his eye back. Horus' eye was a big deal. So the seal of the Egyptian pharaohs was the eye of Horus, and the eye of Horus was going to be right there in the rod. So it's a battle of the rods. And in these battle of the rods, that of course is a conversation of who is really God. So the first round is between Aaron, who becomes the mouthpiece of Moses, and Pharaoh's magicians, who have his rod and the gods, the rods of their gods. And the difference, of course, being that the magicians and Pharaoh would have these very decorative, ornate, jeweled rods. Aaron's rod is just a shepherd's stick. From the outside, this looks like it's going to be no contest. You have Aaron, who represents the slaves, and you have Pharaoh and the magicians, who represent the masters. You have this regular, ordinary shepherd's crook, and then you have over here, you have these decorative gold, silver, jewel-studded rods of different kinds. But then what happens is that Aaron throws his rod down and turns into a snake. That has reference back to Egyptian myths as well. In Egyptian myths, in the first few dynasties, there was a king who was also a priest. He would make wax figures of crocodiles, and he would touch them, and they would become alive. And he touched them again, and they would go back to wax, right? So Aaron throws the rod down, the rod becomes a serpent, and Pharaoh's guys say, no big deal, we can do that, right? So they throw on their rods, right? And their rods become snakes. Well, it seems like it's a tie, until Aaron's snake eats all the other snakes, right? Swallows them up. Then Aaron gets his rod back. It's not just who is more magical. It's a sign of dominance. That the God of Moses and Aaron is a dominant God over the gods of the Egyptians. And the Egyptians also believed that when you consumed something, you brought its life and its power into yourself. So it's a sign that God is so dominant that he can utterly consume the power and the dominance and even the very being of these other gods himself. So that's kind of round one. Round one is between Aaron and his rod and the gods of Egypt and their rods. And so round one, of course, goes to the Lord. Then round two is the round of the plagues. So having won round one, Pharaoh having lost round one, Pharaoh is not content to let the Israelites go. God is not content just to have won the rod battle. Now there has to be further. God tells Moses to go and ask if Pharaoh will let the people go out in the wilderness, make a sacrifice. He won't let them go. So then God says, I am going to bring plagues upon the land. And this becomes a battle between the Lord and Pharaoh. Because Pharaoh was again believed to be an incarnation of the gods. And at the ascension to the throne of Egypt, the pharaohs would agree to maintain something called ma'at, which is order, peace, security. It was believed that the pharaohs were the ones who made summer turn to fall and harvest time come. It was the pharaohs who made the sun rise every day and set every day. It was the pharaohs who kept everything in their natural way. Who kept all the seasons going, who brought the Nile floods and everything. Everything that is natural and necessary for Egyptian life to continue, the pharaohs were believed to be the ones who did by their power, and they took vows and oaths at their ascension to the throne of Egypt to maintain that this was going to keep happening. Right? That makes sense? Now, Egypt was so rich and so powerful because of the Nile River. The Nile River would flood every year. And as it flooded, it would bring this rich sediment into the land. You could plant your crops in this rich soil. And Egypt never went hungry, except when God sends a famine. But Egypt never really goes hungry. The rest of the world always had to come to Egypt to find grain. If you couldn't find food anywhere else, you went to Egypt. That made Egypt, of course, very wealthy, very stable, very secure. This was very important to the Egyptians. And so Pharaoh was made to take an oath upon coming into his office as Pharaoh to maintain this wealth and this stability and this security. The 10 plagues are God demonstrating that Pharaoh is not able to keep his vows. That Pharaoh cannot maintain order. He cannot maintain security. He cannot maintain stability. And so God turns the order of Egypt into chaos. So the big question then, in the 10 plagues, is Pharaoh strong enough to resist God and keep his oaths, even though he's opposed by the God of these slaves, right? So the 10 plagues demonstrate that Pharaoh is a fraud. He can't maintain ma'at, he cannot resist the God even of slaves, and he cannot even rescue his own son, right? All of these things combine to demonstrate for us that Pharaoh and the Egyptian pantheon is powerless in the face of the God of the Bible, the God of these slaves. And we see that becomes part of the point there when we look at Numbers 33, verse 4. Does somebody have Numbers 33, verse 4 for us? Melissa, thanks.
The land that the Lord struck down before the congregation of Israel is a land for livestock, and your servants have... Oh, wait, sorry, it's the wrong verse. While the Egyptians were burying all their firstborn, whom the Lord struck down among them, their gods also the Lord executed judgments.
Who did execute judgment on? The gods, right? It's not just on the Egyptian people, but he executes judgment on the Egyptian gods. Right? The Bible is very plain that this is a divine battle. God is doing battle with the Egyptian gods. And so what we see then, I'm not going to go through every plague, but what we see is that you can look at the 10 different plagues, and you can match them up with an Egyptian god who is meant to be humiliated by this plague. So for instance, the very first plague is the Nile returns to the blood. The Nile was believed to be under the control of the Egyptian god Hapi. He was the god of fertility. When the Nile turns to blood, you can't drink it, you can't do anything with it, you can't water crops with it. It demonstrates that he's unable to keep his promises. You have the plague of frogs, it's a mockery of Pekhet, the frog-headed goddess of divine power and fertility. And all these different plagues have specific gods that they are meant to humiliate and demonstrate that they are entirely powerless. And so we go on, we'll just highlight a couple of these. The plague of locusts. When the locusts destroyed the Nile harvest. The Nile harvest was the pride of Egypt. And it wasn't just one god's role and job to keep the harvest coming year to year to year to year. All the gods were responsible for making sure that the Nile would flood and bring its harvest. So when the locusts come and devour the harvest, God says, none of your gods can do what they say they're going to do. And the high god, at least the high god at this time in Egypt, was the god Amun-Ra, who's the god of the sun. And so when God makes the land of Egypt to be dark for 3 days, he's saying, even your high god doesn't work if I say he can't work. But the last plague, the plague of the firstborn, is a direct attack on Pharaoh himself. Pharaoh can't even save the life of his own son. And the Pharaohs believed, of course, in a regular succession. Pharaoh's son would become Pharaoh, then Pharaoh's son would become, and they believed that these were deified people. They were born deified. And so when God destroys the firstborn son of Pharaoh, he destroys the son of the god. And he throws all of Egypt into chaos. It's one big polemical manifesto. I am God. Your gods are fake gods. And I can destroy them in a series of just days. Let my people go. Right? So we have the plagues are polemic. That means they're not just meant to demonstrate power, they're meant to demonstrate superiority and the truth of Moses' claims and the falsehood of the claims of Pharaoh. What's the main point? What's the main point? The main point of the plagues, the main point of the Exodus, is that the Lord alone is God. We see that in Exodus chapter 10, verse 2. Does somebody have Exodus 10, verse 2 for us? George.
That you may tell your children and grandchildren how I dealt harshly with the Egyptians and how I performed my signs among them, and that you may know that I am the Lord.
What's the point? What's the point of all the plagues? That we will know that he is the Lord. Right? He wanted the Israelites to tell their children, and their children's children, and their children's children. He wanted the Egyptians to know that their gods were fake gods, that the God of the Israelites was the real God. He wanted it to be known, not just in that generation, but for generations to come, who the real God is. And so for the whole rest of the Old Testament, God identifies himself again and again and again and again and again as the God who brought you up out of Egypt. This is God's calling card, right? If God had a business card in the Old Testament, he was going to hand to somebody and say, here's who I am, here's my business. It would say, the Lord who brought his people out of Egypt. That's how God identifies himself from this point forward. And so all of this great work of salvation is really what we call theocentric. It's God-centered. He wants to save his people, yes, but he wants, in saving his people, he wants to demonstrate who he is, that he is the only God. And of course, this establishes for us the bedrock of Christian religion, that there is one God. There is one God. There are not hundreds of gods like the Egyptians had. There's not one God for the sea, and one God for the land, and one God for the hills, and one God for the sun, and an underworld God, and this and that. There's just one God. That God has made all things. He's made the heavens, he's made the earth, and everything in it. And God demonstrates that he is the one God when he brings all these plagues and all these problems upon Egypt. And then that, of course, this demonstration of power leads into God's great act of salvation, where he saves his people out of slavery and brings them into salvation. So I know that some of you are sitting quite a ways back there. I apologize. You can look this map up later. Maybe I can email it out. But you have here the land of Egypt, and the Egyptians require the Israelites to build two cities, Pithom and Ramses. And this is, we know what Ramses is. Pithom is Leicester, but it's probably right about here. So the Exodus begins with the Israelites traveling along this way, and the most likely route is they came down here to the nearest part of the Red Sea. They cross over the Red Sea at this place right here, then they continue on their way down into Mount Sinai. But we really pick up the action then with the Israelites finding themselves at the Red Sea. And the parting and the collapsing of the Red Sea is really kind of the center point of God's work of salvation. Because the people of God find themselves between a rock and a hard place, so to speak. Right? You've got Pharaoh's army, the most powerful army in all the world at the time, on one side. And you've got the Red Sea on the other side. And already right there, you begin to see that there's some discontent with the people of Israel and Moses. Because they say, well, why'd you bring us out here to kill us? Right? And you would think that after seeing the 10 plagues, you'd be able to recognize that, you know, maybe we should trust this Moses guy. Maybe he's got one more trick up his sleeve. Maybe God's going to use him for something. But they're desperate. We don't always think rationally when we're desperate, and so they're desperate, and so they cry out against Moses. But then there's the great story of Moses using his rod, holds up his rod, and the Red Sea parts. And it piles up, and the Israelites walk back through. Moses puts the rod down, and Pharaoh's army is coming through, and the entire army of Pharaoh is destroyed. And that in itself also has a polemical angle to it. Because there's a myth. It's a very interesting myth. There's an ancient Egyptian myth where there was a pharaoh in one of the first few dynasties. And he was very bored. And so he goes to his priest, his high priest, or his chief magician, and he says, I'm bored, nothing satisfies me, tell me how I can be satisfied. So the magician says, okay, well, get all the ladies from your harem, put them all in your boat naked, and while they row and go up and down, you'll be amused by their beauty and all the beauty around you and this lake. Okay, it's disgusting, but people are disgusting, right? So they're on this lake, and all of a sudden, drama hits because one of these ladies from the harem has a turquoise charm around her wrist, and it falls off, and it falls to the bottom of the lake. And she will not be content with any replacement. So the pharaoh says to the magician, fix the problem. And the lake was, you know, 30, 40 feet deep before that. So the magician, according to the myth, cuts the lake in half, takes half of it, and places half the water on top of the other water, piles it up, goes down, gets the charm, gives it back to the lady, then puts the water back where it belongs. Okay? Now, the Egyptians knew that it was myth. Nobody actually believed that it was true. It was cast in a sense of myth. The ancient peoples could use myth in a way they knew wasn't true, but still could act as if it was true. Okay? So when Moses parts the sea, he does very much what this ancient, powerful magician was supposed to have done. He makes the water pile up. He empties it out for the purpose of bringing relief to his people. His people pass through, and then he puts the water back where it belongs. Again, it's another demonstration that God is the true God. What the Egyptians could only imagine in myth could be done. God shows that he, the God of the Hebrews, the God of the Israelites, is able to do in reality. And then also, there's a real good twist on words here, because when the Israelites are getting ready to cross the Red Sea, God separates them from the Egyptians with a cloud. And it says that cloud shines light upon the Israelites and was dark to the Egyptians. The Egyptian high god, again, was the god of the sun. And the sun brings light. In this case, light shines only on the Israelites, and the Egyptians are in darkness. The god of darkness was the god Seth. He was the god of disorder and of chaos, of disaster and death. And so God makes chaos and disorder to be what belongs to the Egyptians and Pharaoh, and makes light to be what belongs to the Israelites. So the Lord divides the people. He divides the Israelites from the Egyptians. He allows the Israelites to pass through. then, of course, Egypt and its army are destroyed in the waters. And that's a heavily referenced event. We see it pop up a number of different times. Somebody have Psalm 78, verse 13. Aaron.
He divided the sea and let them pass through it, and made the water stand like a heap.
Great. How about Isaiah 50, verse 2? Tom.
Why, when I came, was there no man? Why, when I called, was there no one to answer? Is my hand shortened that it cannot redeem? Or have I no power to deliver? Behold, by my rebuke I dry up the sea. I make the rivers a desert. Their fish stink for lack of water and die of thirst.
Great. So the Lord, again, reminds people of his power to divide even the sea. Then look at Zechariah 10, 10 and 11. Somebody have that? Andy.
I will bring them back.
Yeah, so he says bring them back from Egypt, but God in that context in Zechariah is speaking about bringing people back from exile. They're not in Egypt, right? They're actually in Babylon and Assyria, like you mentioned there. But all the rest of the saving acts of God from the point of the Exodus forward are always viewed in Exodus language, right? Exodus becomes the paradigm of salvation for God's people. And so that's what's happening there in Zechariah. How about Psalm 136? Somebody have Psalm 136 that I include that, Josh?
To him who struck down the firstborn of Egypt, his love endures forever, and brought Israel out from among them, his love endures forever. With a mighty hand and outstretched arms, his love endures forever. To him who divided the Red Sea asunder, his love endures forever, and brought Israel through the midst of it, his love endures forever, but swept Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea, his love endures forever.
Yeah, so in this great psalm of praise to God, the great saving act that the psalmist recalls to mind is that he destroyed the Egyptians, and in destroying the Egyptians, he saved his people and leads them out of slavery and into freedom. We see this is picked up on again in the New Testament as well. How about Acts 7:36? Can we have that? Yeah, Kevin.
11 armed eunuchs did wonders and miraculous signs in Egypt, at the Red Sea, and for 40 years in the desert.
Yeah, so we see again that when Stephen is preaching in Acts 7 and he's giving the people of Israel a reminder of what God has done for them, really at the heart of what he recalls to mind for them is that God had parted the Red Sea and let his people walk through on dry ground and had crushed the army of Pharaoh beneath it. Then how about Hebrews 11, 23 to 29? Somebody have that last one, Hebrews 11, 23 to 29. Nobody? I wonder when I would first miss. All right, well, I'll grab that. Hebrews 11, 23-29. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a short time. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry land, but when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. This is a huge biblical event. And in this biblical event, God gives birth, in a way, to his people. This is when his people become a nation of their own. They cease to just be kind of a wandering group of nomads. They're just a kind of a loose amalgamation of some clans. This is when Israel becomes Israel. Of course, others are going to be added into this number, right? Other people will be globbed onto it, even during the count of the Exodus and of the wandering and themselves, other peoples join in or are molded in. But this is when the nation of Israel begins to be a nation. God establishes them here at the parting and the collapsing of the Red Sea. But then we can track back just a touch and we can consider all the implications of what we see in the Passover. But it has to do with that 10th plague. The 10th plague is going to be the plague of all plagues. It was going to be where all the firstborn of all the children, all the families in Egypt were going to lose their firstborn son. And remember that that would have included the Hebrew children as well, unless they had planted the blood of the Lamb above their doors, right? Because Hebrew children are born in sin, and Hebrew families are sinful, just like Egyptian families are sinful. The difference is God's mercy. The difference is that God gives them his word, and they obey his word. They have faith, they trust, right? So by faith, they paint the blood of the Passover lamb above their door. In the evening, then, the angel of the Lord comes by. He passes over, that's where the word passover, he passes over the homes of the Israelites, and he destroys the firstborn of all the people of Egypt. All the Egyptians say, get out of here. Pharaoh himself says, get out of here. The Israelites say, well, give us your silver and your gold and all the food you can and all this kind of stuff. And they say, here, have it. Just get out of here. The Lord had promised that the Israelites would plunder the Egyptians, and they plunder the Egyptians, and they run, and that's when Pharaoh changes his mind to come to the Red Sea. Right? But it's a dramatic story, and God instructs his people that you are to bake bread, but don't use any yeast. We don't have time for yeast. We don't have time for bread to rise. Bake some bread so you have some food for the way, and get out of here as fast as you can. Right? That's where the Feast of the Passover comes from. It's a celebration of God saving his people in a night out of Egypt and delivering them out of the hand of Pharaoh. But in the Passover, we see all kinds of references to Christ. Right? First of all, Moses points us forward to Christ. Moses is a savior. But he's not the Savior. Right? We see Moses fails quite often, actually. He grumbles against God. He complains about his calling. He says, oh, I got uncircumcised lips. He gets frustrated. He hits the rock. Moses isn't allowed to enter into the promised land. Right? Moses is a Savior. But he points us forward to the true Savior, right? Who is Christ. Who comes willingly, gladly, submissively, in perfection to save his people from an enemy much more disastrous and much more horrifying even than Pharaoh. But then we see also the Passover lamb points us to Christ. Right? He is the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sin of the world. That just as the Israelites had to have the blood of the lamb over their doorway if they were going to be saved from the destruction, so too we have to have the blood of the lamb over our lives if we're going to be destroyed, if we're going to be saved from the destruction that God brings in the great day of the Lord. And just as God destroys his enemies in the collapsing of the water and in the 10 plagues, so too God will destroy his enemies through Christ, destroying ultimately sin and death itself. And as the people of God come through the Red Sea and they have new birth as a people and they have life and freedom, so too through Christ we are reborn. We have new life. We have freedom in Christ. And then Paul makes a direct tie between the Red Sea and baptism. In 1 Corinthians 10, verses 1 and 2, does somebody have 1 Corinthians 10? John.
For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers, that our forefathers were all under the cloud, and that they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. What I find particularly interesting about that is that it was the Israelites who didn't get wet. Right? And it was the Egyptians who got wet in the baptism of the sea, right? But what it is that it shows that as far as Paul was concerned, and of course Paul, as far as the Holy Spirit is concerned, the people of God become officially, formally the people of God when God saves them through the Red Sea. That's the moment. That's when God seals them as his people. He promised to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob, but they really become his people, his saved people, in the Red Sea. They're baptized. Well, when do we become part of the people of God? In baptism. Right? We become part of the people of God in baptism. And who went through the sea? Was it only people who were of a certain age? No, it was old, young, infants, right? There's the covenant people of God, as those who had received the promises of God. And so we see even allusions to baptism when we go back into the Red Sea. And we also see there allusions to the Lord's Supper. Because the Passover meal is the meal that Jesus was sharing with his disciples when he changes it and makes it into the Lord's Supper. There's cup. There's bread. It's a meal. It's meant to be a meal of remembrance. It's very natural for the disciples to understand what Jesus was doing and making a sacrament. because the Jews had had a sacrament for centuries, a sacrament of the Passover that they kept. And Jesus takes what's already there and just imputes new meaning into it. Now this is to remind you of what I have done for you. The Exodus is a shadow. The reality is found in Christ. And so we see that the Exodus really ultimately, just like everything else in the scripture, points us forward to Jesus. They might have any questions. That's all I have prepared. Yeah. Frogs are a sign of an unclean spirit. Well, that may be true. The Egyptians attributed different gods to different animals. Different animals would take different, or different gods would take the shape of different animals. And so the frog god had a frog shape. And so it's not just that. It really refers to a god who is in charge of fertility. So you have the second plague is a plague of frogs. The frogs are all over everything, right? And the Egyptians had a god who was the frog-headed goddess of divine power and fertility. Her name was Heket. And so she was in charge. Yeah, power and fertility. Any god associated with the Nile is going to be associated with fertility and power. Because the Nile is an incredibly powerful river. Even though it's dammed up, it's still an incredibly powerful river. And it was the river that brought life to Egypt. Apart from the Nile River, Egypt is just a desert. And the Egyptians recognize that. Yeah, in the Transfiguration, you have, and this is what Kirk was talking about, you have Moses and Elijah. And they show up and they talk with Jesus. That would be a cool time to be present. And they're talking, but in Moses and Elijah, you have really the two chief prophets of the Old Testament. And Moses is the law-giving prophet, and he's, of course, the miracle-working prophet. And Elijah is really the great prophet of the monarch. Right? He does all the different signs and wonders and that kind of thing. And so, but then comes the voice of God, like you were saying, that says, "This is my beloved son. Listen to him." And in these three disciples seeing this, they begin to recognize that Jesus is greater than Moses, and he's greater than Elijah. That if all they're able to listen to, Jesus should be listened to. And Jesus never overturns the law that Moses gives, right? He doesn't say, forget Moses. Jesus properly interprets Moses, right? The Sermon on the Mount is just a proper interpretation of everything that Moses had written in the law. And we'll come to the law. Lord willing, next Sunday we'll come to Mount Sinai. We'll look at the place of the law, how it stands still, and how it some of it's been fulfilled already. But Moses is an important figure, even for Christ. And Jesus knew the law better than anybody else, and knew its heart better than anybody else. Because Moses didn't circumcise his son. Moses was difficult in many ways. Perhaps Moses' wife, Zipporah, didn't want to have her son, Gershom, right, that was his son, didn't want to have him circumcised, we don't exactly know. But the Lord comes because Moses had been disobedient. God's people and their children are to receive the sign of the covenant. And Moses had failed to put the sign of the covenant on his child. And so if Moses is going to lead the people of God, he better be leading with a good example. People were commanded to circumcise their children. Moses hadn't. So God comes to kill. We don't exactly know what that looks like. But then Zipporah takes the flint, circumcises her son, and puts the foreskin on his feet. You are a bridegroom of blood to me. Right? Yeah. But, yeah. Obedience matters, right?
Yeah.
Obedience matters. Yeah. Yeah, certainly. You see, in the wanderings, and unfortunately we're going to pass by the wanderings for the most part, and we'll skip more over to Joshua. There were faithful Israelites. Caleb and Joshua are kind of the example par excellence of faithful Israelites. And then there are lots of unfaithful Israelites. But all the while, there are also people who come into the people of God, even during the wilderness wanderings. So the people of God multiply naturally by birth on the Exodus wanderings, but they also multiply by people coming in and joining them. They've heard what the Israelite God has done to Egypt. We want to be a part of that. So the people of God who enter into Canaan look genetically different than the people who exited out of Egypt. We see that, and that carries on in stories like Ruth, who comes into the people of God. There's always this inflow in, and there's always some who are among Israel who really aren't, at heart, Israelites. which is why the whole generation who passes through the cloud, baptized in the sea, dies in the wilderness, including Moses. If you see a group of hundreds of thousands of people wandering around looking for a place to call home, you want to make sure they don't call your place home, right? So that's why when the Israelites are wandering and they pass by the borders of Moab and Ammon, the Ammonites, they don't want to have anything to do with the Israelites either. The Israelites say, can we walk through your land, right? You're our distant relatives. The Ammonites were descendants of Lot. And they say no. And they don't even just say no. They say no and they hire Balaam to put a curse on the Israelites. So the peoples around Israel were frightened because of the numbers of the Israelites, but they were also frightened because they'd heard of the God of the Israelites had done to the Egyptians. If God could do that to the Egyptians, the most powerful country on earth, what could he do to us, right? That put the fear of God into all the people around them. Yeah, there's certainly some crossover between the church is called to, I think, be less political than the church has been historically, at least in this country. We've been in a unique position where the church has actually had extreme amounts of political influence, which has been used for good and not as much for good sometimes. But the church is called to be first and foremost a spiritual outpost of the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God invites all people, right? Who will come in obedience and faith. And so, there's a reason we don't have people checking green cards at the door, right? Like, you can have your views on immigration and that sort of thing, but as a church, we're not an outpost of America. We're an outpost of Christ. I'll get myself in trouble, but I always have had an issue with having flags in church. And not because I don't appreciate being an American. I do appreciate being an American. But because I think it's important that the church is the church. The church is the outpost of the kingdom of God. And the church is meant to be built and belong to people of all different ethnicities and kingdoms. And so how we feel about immigration politically should have very little bearing on whether or not we're willing to offer hospitality, kindness, and the gospel to people who come. And absolutely, I think it has bearing. We're spiritually descendants of the Israelites. And so our history is of being immigrants and wanderers. That was a good way to dodge the pop political identity question. So that's a good question. So Brad asked, in Exodus 12, many other peoples join the Israelites as they leave. And I think the best understanding of that is that other Asiatic peoples who were oppressed peoples also left. The Egyptians leave no historical record of the Exodus, which makes perfect sense. The Egyptians lost major battles with tens of thousands of deaths, and they wouldn't say a word about it, right? We've found records of major Egyptian losses. They don't say anything, right? They only record their successes. But the other peoples along with the Egyptians who were oppressed by the tens and hundreds of thousands of people, if they saw an opportunity to leave, if they saw a God who could do that to Egypt, wouldn't you hop in? I certainly would, right? So I think it's other more Asiatic immigrant peoples who hop in. And of course, those people are not biological descendants of Abraham. And so, you have tribes, and each of the 12 tribes receives an allotment in the land, but those families would glob on to a tribe. They don't have any biological connection to it. So even from the very beginning, the people of God, the Old Testament people of God, was much less about genetics and much more about who is your God. And that's the same with the church. Next time we're looking at Mount Sinai and the law, so read Exodus 19 and 20. If you're following along in Christ and the covenants, we'll be looking at chapter 10.